Dear students, today I'll deal with surgical treatment of chronic suppurative otitis media. You may recall what chronic suppurative otitis media is. The cardinal signs, that is discharge, deafness, and perforation. These three must be there to diagnose a case as chronic suppurative otitis media. So, in other words, it is suppuration of the middle ear cavity. I have already mentioned in my last class. And it is chronic suppuration, long standing suppuration of the middle ear cavity. And there are two main varieties. One is a safe variety, other is the unsafe variety. The safe variety is also called tubotympanic type of otitis media, whereas the other variety, that is called eticoantral type of otitis media or tympanomastoid type of otitis media. Latest terminology is the tubotympanic type of otitis media is known as mucosal type of otitis media, whereas the eticoantral disease type of otitis media is called squamosal type of otitis media. The main difference between these two is the discharge, type of perforation, and prognosis from hearing point of view, as well as the from the point of view of the complications and prognosis and even threat to life. So the eticoantral type of otitis media is associated with what is known as cholesteatoma, which is skin at wrong place. It is a misnomer since there is no cholesterol crystals nor oma. Even though oma is there at the end, it doesn't have anything to do with the tumor. So it is a misnomer. So the better word is keratosis. Because of the tradition, we continue to say or teach as cholesteatoma throughout the world. Now, cholesteatoma has got a very peculiar character of eroding and destroying bone. The middle ear cavity is very, very closely connected to intracranium and other vital structures. So, if the cholesteatoma destroys the bone, the infection will readily enter the intracranium. In our next class, future classes, we'll be dealing about the complications, how do they occur, and how to diagnose, and how to treat them. So you have to be familiar with the diagnosis of chronic suppurative otitis media. Not only simple diagnosis, you have to diagnose the type of otitis media, because both are totally different, both from management point of view and also from prognosis point of view. Now, as you all know, the treatment of tubotympanic type of otitis media is basically conservative. That is, you will gently mop the ear with a sterile cotton swab and make it dry and use specific antibiotic as per the culture tests, both topically as well as systemically. So once the ear is dry, there is no more discharge, then there will be a a perforation remaining. This is called permanent perforation syndrome. If the perforation is small, say about a few millimeters, it will heal in course of time. If you keep the ear dry, if you don't allow any water inside your ear, and if you treat all upper respiratory tract infections in time adequately, the condition will resolve and the perforation also heals. Patient will have intact drum head and he'll have normal hearing, near normal hearing, almost normal hearing, because the hearing part, it is a scar drum head, so it might have a few decibel loss. If the perforation is larger, say for instance, if it is a kidney shaped perforation or a very large perforation, it doesn't heal. Moreover, if there is an upper respiratory tract infection which is unattended, it may give rise to fresh attack of otitis media. Not only that, accidentally, if infected water goes to the ear, then also patient starts discharging. To avoid this particular embarrassment and to achieve a total cure of the disease, we have to take up surgical treatment. So what type of surgical treatment you will advise in case of this, in case of a tympanomastoid type of otitis media? You have to repair the drum head. How do we repair the drum head? By means of what is known as myringoplasty. Myringo means connected to the tympanic membrane. Myringoplasty means it is connected to tympanic membrane. Now, plasty is repair. Myringo means tympanic membrane. So this particular procedure, there are three varieties. First is the onlay variety or overlay variety. Second is inlay variety or interlay variety. So coming to the first variety, the onlay variety, the tympanic membrane, the graft material, that is the material that is used for repair of the tympanic membrane, is placed lateral to the annulus tympanicus. This is onlay tympanoplasty, onlay myringoplasty. And if the graft material is placed underneath the annulus tympanicus, then we will call it as inlay type of myringoplasty or underlay type of myringoplasty. If both these types are used in the same patient, we call it as interlay type of myringoplasty. So among these three varieties, what we all practice, what most popular variety is the inlay type of myringoplasty. Yes. Now, what is the material you employ? You have to employ a material which is akin to or similar to the tympanic membrane. We have got several materials. The fascia covering the temporalis muscle, or the perichondrium overlying the conchal cartilage or tragal cartilage, or a vein graft and so on and so forth. Sometimes the cartilage itself is being used as a graft material. Once again, out of all these graft materials, the most popular one and the most used material which throughout the world is the fascia covering the temporalis muscle. That is temporal fascia. So why do we prefer temporalis fascia or temporal fascia? What is its greatness? First and foremost is it is similar to tympanic membrane. It is thin, tough. The texture, the width, and the character is almost like a normal tympanic membrane. And it is readily available in plenty. This the entire muscle is temporalis muscle. There is a fascia overlying it. So temporalis fascia is available readily. And you need not take a separate incision. Say for example, you want to harvest a triangle cartilage, you have to take a separate incision. So you need not take a separate incision. It is available locally. And not only that, the temporalis fascia has got a low basal metabolic rate. What does it imply? That means it stays longer. It stays longer even though the blood supply is cut off. If you are taking a graft that is a piece of temporalis fascia and leave it, what will happen? It slowly gets dried up and as blood supply is cut off, it will become non-vital. But the temporalis, any tissue for that matter, if there is no blood supply, it will become non-vital. But this particular temporalis fascia stays live longer than other materials. It is proved. So this is a wonderful aspect which made the temporalis fascia very, very powerful. Now, how do we do it? The procedure again, for any ear surgery, I remember I have mentioned in my last classes, for any ear surgery, three approaches we employ. The first and foremost is permeatal approach. That means we take the incision inside the ear canal and do the operation. This is permeatal approach. There is one more approach called post-oral approach or post-auricular approach. That is, we take an incision behind the exnatric canal. This is post-auricular approach. Whereas, there is a third approach called end-oral approach. What is end-oral approach? We'll approach the exnatric canal, we'll approach the middle ear cavity permeatally. Again, we'll make a small radial incision from the first incision through the extracartilaginous part, that is incisura angularis of the cartilage of pinna above. This is called end oral approach. Some people prefer end oral to post oral. Some other people will prefer the post oral approach. Mostly post oral approach is very, very popular. With this approach, generally what we do is we elevate the tympanometal flap, that is the flap consisting of metal skin, annulus tympanicus, and the remnant tympanic membrane as a single entity and elevate anteriorly and introduce the fascia under this particular tympanometal flap. This is only type of myringoplasty. This is inlay or underlay type of myringoplasty, which we are all following. As I told you, overlay type of myringoplasty, in overall type of myringoplasty, we elevate the tympanometal flap, but we don't elevate the annulus. What is the outer cover of the tympanic membrane? Nothing but squamous epithelium. So this epithelial lining along with the tympanometal flap we elevate. That means the middle fibrous layer, the annulus tympanicus, the mucous membrane, they are all left untouched. And this is elevated and introduce the graft and replace the flap. This is onlay type of myringoplasty. And in case of interlay type of myringoplasty, we elevate the tympanometer flap posteriorly, like in underlay type of myringoplasty or inlay type of myringoplasty. But as we come anterior, we elevate like overlay type of myringoplasty. That means we are employing the both techniques. Now, in certain circumstances, before undertaking the myringoplasty directly, you will have suppose you have strong suspicion there is a pocket of sepsis or some disease left behind in the mastoid. Unless you clear the disease, your surgery will not be successful. So you may have to do what is known as a cortical mastectomy. Previously, it used to be called as simple mastectomy or Schwartz mastectomy. Now it is, the terminology is clear, it is called complete mastectomy. Why do you call it as complete mastectomy? Just because we remove all the mastoid cells and make them into a single common cavity. So mastectomy is defined as systematic excentration of all the accessible mastoid cells and making them into a single common cavity. That is simple mastectomy or complete mastectomy. As you see the picture, you can see this is the ear canal. This is the ear canal, whereas this is the mastoid bone. Why do you call this bone, this particular mastoid part of the temporal bone as mastoid? I think all of you know it. That is, it looks like a female breast. Now, coming back to the operation proper, suppose we have taken a post-auricular incision like this. This post-auricular incision is named after one scientist called William Weil. William Weil's incision, that is superiorly from the level of the zygoma, about a few millimeters behind the retroauricular sulcus. It is a curvilinear incision going down up to the tip. But in case of children, this should be modified. Why? Because the mastoid process is ill developed. As a result, there is a vital structure here, that is, this is the styloid process. So just medial to the styloid process, there is stylomastoid foramen through which the facial nerve emerges out. Now, in case of children, as the mastoid tip is not properly formed, this particular facial nerve is almost subcutaneous. If you take a liberal incision, just like in an adult, you'll be sectioning the facial nerve through and through. So in case of children, the incision should be modified. That is, you start like an adult and make it more or less horizontal, well away from the tip of the mastoid, fully developed tip of the mastoid. So by means of drill, you elevate, you drill out, you excentrate or you open all the diseased and accessible mastoid cells and making them into a single common cavity. First, we identify the mastoid antrum, which is nothing but biggest mastoid cell. And all the mastoid cells are open. When do we call the operation complete? First and foremost is, you have to define various structures. Say, this area is called the tegmen. How is the middle ear cavity is separated from the intracranium? By means of a very, very thin plate of bone, say about 2 to 3 millimeters thickness, that is tegmen. So the part of the tegmen that overlies the middle ear cavity is called tegmen tympani, which continues posteriorly as tegmen antri, because this particular bone is above the mastoid antrum, tegmen antri. So you have to delineate the tegmen, number one. Number two, the middle ear cavity is communicating with the mastoid bone. How? By means of a way, by means of a canal called auditus ad antrum. Auditus ad antrum. This auditus ad antrum, it communicates the middle ear cavity from the mastoid air cell system. So you have to identify the auditus ad antrum. Not only identifying the auditus ad antrum, there is a structure peeping through the auditus ad antrum, that is the short process of incus. You have to define the short process of incus. Unless you define the short process of incus, your mastectomy is not complete. Coming back, this particular vitis structure is the a bone covering the sigmoid sinus. You know what sigmoid sinus is? Sigmoid sinus or lateral sinus, it is formed by the from the transverse sinus. Transverse sinus, it will take a bend and form the sigmoid sinus, which continues downwards as lateral jugular vein. So it is a pool of blood. One should be extremely careful not to injure it. If you injure it accidentally, it will give rise to torrential bleeding. Then you have to apply a suitable pressure, apply surgicel or gel foam or a piece of muscle or bone wax and control it. Now, this area is called sino-dural angle. That means angle between the sinus and dura. The what is the part just overlying the tegmen? That is dura, nothing but dura. So this is sino-dural angle. There are cells in the sino-dural angle too. Now, this is the tip of the mastoid. There are mastoid tip cells. So you have to define the auditus ad antrum and the short process of incus. You have to identify the middle fossa, dura, that is the with a bony plate, that is tegmen. You have to identify the sinodural angle and you have to identify the sinus plate. And inferiorly, you have to identify the what is known as digastric ridge. Digastric ridge, it is a something like a ridge or a triangular prominence, which is related medially with the digastric muscle. So you have to identify the digastric ridge also. So this makes the mastectomy complete. So the next type of mastectomy is called modified radical mastectomy. What is radical? What is radical? Radical means something very, I don't know how to describe. Radical means total or something, absolute or something. So radical mastectomy is knock out everything in the mastoid. Say for instance, mastectomy we already dealt with, that is systematic excentration of all the diseased and accessible mastoid hair cells and making them into a single common cavity. Whereas in case of radical mastectomy, along with the mastoid, we also remove the damaged ossicles, damaged tympanic membrane, and also we also remove the mucosa also. We remove the mucosa also that is damaged. This is radical mastectomy. This is done in pre-antibiotic era. Nowadays, there is no practical indication for this radical mastectomy. As you all know, when you knock out everything, what is the end result? There will be total hearing loss. Of course, the sensorineural component is still might be, the conductor component is totally gone and some hearing might be left behind. But if you do a radical mastectomy, the hearing loss is almost complete. So we do what is known as a modified radical mastectomy. One surgeon called Bondi has modified this radical mastectomy. That is why we call it as Bondi's modification. Now, what do we do in this particular type of surgery? First and foremost is we'll do a complete mastectomy as before. Then we do what is known as we'll remove the posterior bony meatal wall. See, this is the end result of a complete mastectomy, and this is the ear canal, and this is the posterior bony meatal wall. That is this bony meatal wall separates the middle ear cavity and axonotic canal from the mastoid cavity. In modified radical mastectomy, we'll remove this also. That means we are making mastoid cavity and also middle ear cavity, axonotic canal into a single cavity. So how will you define modified radical mastectomy? Modified radical mastectomy is defined as systematic excentration of the all the diseased and accessible mastoid hair cells and making them into a single common cavity by removing the posterior bony meatal wall and also exteriorizing the cavity into the axonotic canal by means of what is known as a meatoplasty opening. This is modified radical mastectomy. That means we remove the all the diseased mastoid hair cells and remove the posterior bony meatal wall also. Not only that, we also remove the bridge. What is bridge? Bridge is the lateral wall of the auditus ad antrum. Auditus ad antrum is a way, is a tube-like pathway between the medullary cavity and the mastoid. Now, the lateral wall of the auditus ad antrum is called the bridge. We will remove the bridge also. Not only that, we will also do what is known as lowering of the facial ridge. Now, what is facial ridge? Facial ridge is the bone that overlies the facial nerve. That is called facial ridge. It is also known as posterior buttress. Why do we call this posterior buttress? Because it is, this area is area lies behind, that is behind the, in the posterior aspect of the field. So in contrast to posterior buttress, there is an anterior buttress also. That is, after removal of the bridge, you will find another bony part of the mastoid in the anterior aspect. That is called anterior buttress. So anterior buttress is that part of the bone of the mastoid which lies between the zygomatic portion and the zygomatic portion of the mastoid portion above the level of the facial nerve. And then do what is known as a myotoplasty. Myotoplasty, as I have already mentioned, we'll make an opening in the posterior canal skin and exteriorize the whole mastoid and the middle ear cavity, mastoid cavity, into the ear canal so that we can periodically inspect and attend if there is any disease, and we'll see that the mastoid cavity is well aerated. Where do we do this modified radical mastoidectomy? In case of chronic suppurative otitis media of aticoantral variety. What is aticoantral type of otitis media? It is associated with chronic, it is associated with cholesteatoma. So cholesteatoma, how does it look like? It is a semi-solid material, putty like, dirty white in color, sometimes glistening white, and it is very soft. So it is like a damaged butter, foul smelling. So this particular cholesteatoma must be totally removed, otherwise there will be remnant and it will recur. So for a dressal of the cholesteatoma, we do this particular surgery called modified radical mastoidectomy. So in modified radical mastoidectomy, even in best hands, the cholesteatoma can recur. For that, we should do very meticulous surgery, remove the entire squamous epithelium without leaving behind any remnant. Even in hidden areas, there are some hidden areas that are, see, the eustachian tubal area, that is supratubal recess, and also in the case of sinus tympani, that is medial to the facial nerve covering or facial ridge, and also in case of in the hypotympanic pen region or the sinodural angle region or in the tip. So these are all the hidden areas where there may be some remnants of cholesteatoma. Also, we should be careful and remove the whole disease and do a proper myotoplasty, because the philosophy of cholesteatoma surgery is expose, excise, and exteriorize. Expose the cholesteatoma and excise the cholesteatoma in toto and exteriorize it so that there will be proper aeration. And there is minimal chances of recurrence. In this particular surgery is not without complications. It has got its own complications because you are making a big cavity, which you can see through the ear canal, through this vitreoplasty opening. And this cavity, naturally, it attracts some fungus or some bacteria, and the wax accumulates. Sometimes granulations form. Sometimes this cavity may be discharging. This is called mastoid cavity problem. So this is a real problem because patient continuously, he may be complaining something or other. So more or less, this is a doctor dependent cavity. Once in a while, you have to look into the ear and clean it, clean the ear very carefully. Not only that, you are leaving a big cavity behind the ear. If patient is exposed to cold weather or hot weather, patient may have caloric effect and may patient complain of vertigo, especially if the individual is traveling in a two-wheeler where the air currents directly, they will go and hit the pinna. Patient naturally may have some sort of giddiness. And of course, he cannot swim. For the simple reason, again, patient may have, again, during swimming, water may go into the cavity and may produce infection, or may have the caloric effect again in vertigo. So because of all these, many people, especially in the Western world, they do not accept this. But in a country like ours, wherein there is no insurance system, patient has to pay from the pocket, and patient he cannot undergo surgery for repeatedly for cholecystoma. If recurs again, you have to operate. So repeated surgeries patient cannot afford in a country like ours. So we directly do a modified radical mastoidectomy. And once in a while, he comes with some wax or accumulation, we clean it. This is best for a country like ours. But the Western society, they will not accept this. So they don't want a cavity. They want the entire cholecystoma to be removed or treated. And the another important aspect of modified radical mastoidectomy is hearing. Hearing will definitely, it will be less. As I have previously mentioned, there will be what is known as a cholecystoma hearing. When the entire ear canal is, not ear canal, entire the middle ear is filled with the cholecystoma, it acts like a very good conductor of the hearing for the sound energy. The sound energy, it travels very effectively through cholecystoma. Now, if you remove the cholecystoma, what happens? The hearing will naturally go down. Of course, we do everything to improve patient's hearing by doing tympanoplasty, meningoplasty, things like that. In spite of all this, patient does have some sort of hearing loss. So patient doesn't want a cavity, patient wants the hearing to be a status quo, or patient wants hearing to be improved after surgery, and he should be complication free, he wants. So this particular technique called combined approach tympanoplasty, or CAT, combined approach tympanoplasty, this technique has emerged. What is combined approach tympanoplasty? First and foremost is anterior tympanotomy. What is anterior tympanotomy? Elevation of the tympanometal flap, as I mentioned just now, in case of varicoplasty. Then complete mastoidectomy. Already you know what complete mastoidectomy is. Next is the posterior tympanotomy. This posterior tympanotomy is a highly skilled procedure, whereas you will not remove the posterior bony meatal wall as you do in modified radical mastectomy, but you will make an opening without injuring the facial nerve carefully and peep into the middle ear cavity, see the middle ear cavity, and remove the cholecystoma if any. This is posterior tympanotomy. And lastly, it is completed by doing a tympanoplasty, that is repair of the whole middle ear structure. That is, the tympanic membrane is repaired by means of a graft, either by fascia or by pericardium. And the ossicles, diseased ossicles, they are also repaired. How do they repair? What is the material that we employ for the repair of the ossicles? We may use the same ossicle with re-sculpturing it, especially the incus, or we may have say the homograft cartilage. We can take the cartilage from the nasal septum and we can drill it out in the form of an ossicle and apply it. Sometimes we may have synthetic materials also, like hydroxyapatite or Teflon. There are varieties of these ossicular replacement processes. If you have to replace both stapes and incus, then we call it as TORP, that is total ossicular replacement processes, TORP, total ossicular replacement processes. But sometimes the stapes is intact, then we may have to do what is known as partial ossicular replacement processes, that is PARP. We may have to use a PARP, either PARP or TARP are used for repair of the ossicles. Now the current trend is we use the PARP and TARP. Previously they were made up of Teflon. Now they are made up of more biogenically acceptable material, that is titanium. Though it's expensive, it is very, very rewarding. So the tympanoplasty means we have to do repair of the middle ear mechanism. Damaged tympanic membrane is repaired by a graft material like temporalis fascia or pericardium, whereas the damaged ossicles are also there repaired. Now, this is called tympanoplasty. So this is divided into, say, five varieties. First and foremost is called the myringoplasty, that is you repair only the remnant tympanic membrane. That is called myringoplasty, otherwise known as type 1 tympanoplasty. Type 1 tympanoplasty is otherwise known as myringoplasty. Now, type 2 tympanoplasty, it is called incus version. What is incus version? You remove the diseased incus and you sculpture it and replace it between the stapes and the malleus. That means this is more or less like a normal ossicular chain, but in a different shape. That is why we call it as incus version. That is type 2. The third variety is called malleostapedopexy. What is malleostapedopexy? That is the graft directly overlies over the stapes. There is no ossicle between malleus and stapes. Malleus is there, it's okay, but as incus is gone, the graft is directly applied over the stapes. That is malleostapedipraxy, otherwise known as type 3 temporoplasty. The fourth type is called columellar type. In the columellar type of meningoplasty is, suppose malleus, incus, and the stapes are also gone, especially the entire stapes may not go usually. Usually the footplate remains. So the superstructure is gone. Then we do what is known as columellar type of temporoplasty. I hope all of you know what columella is. Columella is a single ossicle that is present in lower animals. What is the important mammalian characteristic? Three ossicles. In case in place of single ossicle, that is columella, there are three ossicles in case of the mammals, malleus, incus, and stapes. So columella is single ossicle that is seen in lower animals, especially the birds. Now, keeping that in mind, it is named as columella. That is a single ossicle that is directly from foot plate to the tympanic membrane. Either the normal tympanic membrane or neotympanic membrane, we'll put a only single ossicle. That is called columella. There is a fifth variety, otherwise known as solo inversion. Very, very interesting, but very rarely people do it. In case of solo inversion, what they do is, we apply the tympanic membrane over the promontory and leave behind the round window area. That means in normal aerotympanic, route of sound transmission is directly from the tympanic membrane through ossicles, through the vowel window, and into the scala vestibuli to helicotrema, and come and the vibrations, they die down at the level of the round window membrane. This is the normal aerotympanic route. So in case of solo inversion, as round window is exposed, it is other way around. That is, from the round window is exposed to atmosphere. That's why it's otherwise known as secondary tympanic membrane. So it gets the vibrations, and the vibrations are carried into the inner ear. It's a very interesting and theoretical type of temporoplasty. You can go through this picture. This is the, suppose the tympanic membrane is like this, and there is the graft is applied over the malleus handle. That is type 1 meningoplasty. The the graft may be either lateral to the malleus handle, or sometimes it may be medial to the malleus handle. But the graft is, as a rule, applied under the annulus tympanicus. That is why we call it as inlet type of meningoplasty, type 1. In case of type 2, that is incus version, which I have just now told you, the graft is applied over the malleus as well as incus. It touches malleus as well as the incus. This is type 2. The third variety is the graft directly touches the stapes head. This is type 3. Malleostapedipraxy or meningostapedipraxy in two senses of the term. Meningostapedipraxy, that is this particular tympanic membrane directly in contact with the stapes head. This type 4 variety they have described as graft directly placed over the foot plate or vowel window region. They call it as type 4. And this type 5, we call it as a fenestra, that is opening made for the semicircular canal. And the sound waves, they are supposed to travel through the lateral semicircular canal into the inner ear. And the other variety I have already mentioned, that is sono inversion. This is also sono inversion. that is called one that is described by one scientist called Garcia Ibanez. Now let us have a look at the videos of these various procedures. See, this is how a mastectomy is done. This is the post-auricular route. Already an incision is taken, the curvilinear incision directly at the, from the level of the zygoma to the tip, and excise the muscle as well as the periosteum and reflectus anterior and posterior by means of using what is known as a mastoid retractor. This is the mastoid drill we employ for ear surgery. This is the dental drill we employ it for dissecting the bone. Previously we used to use gauze and hammer and remove the bone. Now carefully we remove all the mastoid air cells. See, now the dissection is being done near the adductus aryantrum region. Now see this. This is the posterior bony meatal wall. We make it as very thin bone. The entire posterior bony meatal wall is made very, very thin. See, the posterior canal skin is being elevated here. This is the area of the adductus aryantrum. It is being defined by using a smaller size bar. See, all the mastoid air cells are excentrated. This is the complete mastectomy. You can identify the short pars esophagus at this area. Now, what is modified radical mastectomy? The complete mastectomy is done, and then as I told you, this is the posterior bony meatal wall which is made very thin. See, this is the posterior bony meatal wall. He has removed the bony meatal wall, but this surgeon is trying to reconstruct it. That means modified radical mastectomy is mastectomy, removal of the posterior bony meatal wall, and you will be directly on the facial nerve covering by a bone. And this area is called the anterior buttress region, and this area is called the posterior buttress region. and this is the meningoplasty which I was mentioning as type 1 timpanoplasty. See, the ear is prepared. The surgery is done under general anesthesia as well as local anesthesia. In case of children and uncooperative adults, we do it under general anesthesia. Otherwise, it is very effectively or easily done without general anesthesia under local anesthesia. The graft is being taken. We'll show you how the graft is made. See, this is the fascia I'm talking about. This is the fascia covering the temporalis muscle. We are exposing this muscle is being cut. More fascia is exposed. So this is the fascia which I'm talking about. A suitable size fascia is being taken. Right. This is being applied on a, say, on a glass shield and made it to dry. So by the time we apply it, it will become somewhat stiff. Now the posterior bony, this meatal skin is elevated here like this. What is the structure? This is called spine of Henle. Its importance is mastodontum lies 1.25 centimeters below this level. Spine of Henle is being drilled out. This is the posterior meatal skin. See, mastoid is not opened at all. Mastoidectomy is not done. Only meningoplasty. That is the repair of the perforation. See how the posterior meatal skin is elevated. Once we elevate the posterior meatal skin, then a meatotomy has to be done. By means of a knife, see, the skin is divided transversely. So you divided the skin. See, we can see the remnant tympanic membrane here. We can see better now. Yes, now we can see the remnant tympanic membrane. See this? They are the edges of the perforation. So this is the perforation, this is the remnant tympanic membrane. I mean, this is micro scissors. Patient is, the surgeon is using a micro scissors. And he is making the perforation, edges of the perforation raw. unless we make the edges of the perforation raw, the graft may not be taken up, because it's a long-standing problem. There will be squamous cells at the edge. See, the tympanometal flap is elevated very carefully. We will go back. See, this is how the tympanometal flap is elevated. This is called Rogen's knife, otherwise known as horizontal knife or round knife. This is the area of the annulus tympanicus. By means of a sharp hook at the level of the annulus tympanicus, the surgeon is elevating the tympanometal flap. This structure, what is the structure? This is chorda tympani nerve. Very carefully, we have to elevate this tympanometal flap. The chorda should not be damaged or destroyed, because it carries the taste sense, taste fibers. So throughout the tympanometal flap is raised. Except at the anterior region. Go back, already fascia is introduced. From here you can see this is the tympanometal flap which the surgeon has elevated, and this is the handle of the malleus. Of course, the stapes IS joint is here, infundibulostapular joint is here. Now the temporal fascia graft, which has already been harvested and dried, it is taken, and see, this is how the dried graft looks like. So gently it is introduced. The surgeon is keeping the graft underneath the malleus handle. In other words, it is called exteriorization of the malleus handle. It's not absolutely necessary. We can keep it over the malleus handle also. See this. So, like that, the temporalis fascia is already introduced, and this is the perforation, and this is repaired by the graft, and they are called small gel foam pieces. They act like a support both underneath the graft and over the graft also. They support, and slowly they get absorbed, and the entire wound is closed after packing the ear canal with gel foam, either plain gel foam or medicated gel foam. Thank you all.
మొత్తం వస్తా సార్ అంటే రికార్డెడ్ వీడియో డౌన్లోడ్ అవుతుంది.